Hi, I'm Arun George, and you're listening to Three Things, the Indian Express news show. In today's episode, we're taking a closer look at fantasy gaming platform Dream 11 becoming the Indian Premier League's title sponsor and the questions it raises. Then, we're looking at the Supreme Court handing a case related to the death of actor Sushant Singh Rajput to the Central Bureau of Investigation. But first, we're looking at the Madhya Pradesh Chief Minister's promise to reserve government jobs for the state's residents.
Madhya Pradesh Sarkar ne ek mahatvapurna faisla kiya hai. Madhya Pradesh ki shaskiya naukriyan ab keval Madhya Pradesh ke bachchon ko di jayegi. Iske liye hum avashyak kanuni pravdhan kar rahe hain.
That's Madhya Pradesh Chief Minister Shivraj Singh Chauhan announcing that state government jobs will be reserved for Madhya Pradesh's children. An official statement quoted Chauhan as saying that only students of the state will be absorbed in the government services in Madhya Pradesh. This was a follow-up to a statement made on Independence Day announcing that the state's residents would be given preference in government jobs. Iram Siddiqui, who reported on the development, joins us now to explain the implications of this announcement. So, Iram, could you explain what the Chief Minister said about reserving jobs for locals in the state government?
So, the Madhya Pradesh Chief Minister Shivraj Singh Chauhan on Tuesday morning released a video on his Twitter handle saying that the government jobs in Madhya Pradesh will be reserved for the children of Madhya Pradesh and that the necessary legal provisions would be made. He further went on to add that the resources of the state are only for the children of this state.
And do we know any of the details of this yet?
So as of now, the government hasn't given further details. But from what we've learned from the state administration is that in the coming days, a committee would be formulated to draft a guideline for the implementation and to make a legal provision for the same. However, even if that happens, this decision will not affect the ongoing recruitment process that is already underway. Also, they will be applicable to the examination conducted by the Public Service Commission and the Professional Board. These are the two recruiting agencies for the state government on which 100% reservation for the state candidates will come into play. However, further details on the same are awaited as of now.
But does Madhya Pradesh already have any kind of reservations in place for, say, state jobs other than the caste-based reservation?
So Madhya Pradesh does have a caste-based reservation, like a 50% reservation for the general category, 16% for SC, 20% for ST, and 14% for backward class. Apart from this, they also have a zilla-wise reservation, which varies for every district, depending upon the extent of the tribal population in that particular district. So that is different for different districts. And beyond that, they also have a 33% reservation for women whenever, depending upon the vacancies. And there is an ongoing case for 20% reservation for other backward classes. So these are the general reservations that are there into play in MP as of now.
So the previous Congress-led government with Chief Minister Kamal Nath had also made a promise that they would reserve jobs for locals. How far did that go and how different is this from that?
The reservation that the Kamal Nath government backed in 2018 was for the private sector, basically wherein the government had proposed an amendment to the Industrial Act, reserving 70% of jobs for the local people. And it was under the Madhya Pradesh MSME Protsahan Yojana. It was largely an incentive-based scheme wherein an industrial company or an MSME, in order to avail benefits from the government, from getting land on subsidized rate to other such discounts or incentives from the government, would have to make reservation for the local youth, which is up to 70% jobs would be given for them. And that is into play in the state as of now.
So what are political opponents saying about this move by the state government?
Soon after the video was released by the chief minister, several political opponents like the former chief minister and state Congress president Kamal Nath took to Twitter and pointed out that a policy like this has a lot of challenges in its implementation, and that ahead of the by-elections on the 27 seats in the Chambal and Gwalior region, this is just a political gimmick. And Kamal Nath also pointed out that the state government, the BJP-led state government, has woken up to the needs of the youths and the children of the state after 15 years. He also said that this is another way of the government to just fool the children, whereas Member of Parliament for Rajya Sabha, Mr. Vivek Tankha, in an open letter to the Chief Minister, has pointed out that there are about 1 crore students from Madhya Pradesh which presently go out of the state to pursue education. That highlights the poor education facility within the state. He has also pointed out that if tomorrow the other states also make such reservations, only allowing students in their state to seek admission, it will definitely pose a big challenge for the children of Madhya Pradesh.
Iram also says that political opponents have accused the Chief Minister of merely making a token announcement ahead of important by-polls for 27 seats in the state.
Everybody is saying that it's a political masterstroke ahead of the election, which is understood because the Shivraj Singh government is also citing COVID as one of the reasons and not letting these parties campaign. Recently, the Shivraj Singh government had issued orders saying that the campaign for the by-election should not happen because that would lead to people crowding and might also take up the COVID positive tally in the state. While on the other hand, the government is announcing such schemes while the election dates are yet to be announced. So there is this sense that the government is on purpose trying to defer the dates of the election and not allowing political opponents to campaign citing COVID.
Despite the Chief Minister's announcement, one big hurdle that his plan faces is that courts have routinely struck down state governments granting jobs based on domicile. The Indian Express's Apurva Vishwanath has analyzed how courts treat job reservations by state governments, and she joins us now to explain the challenges the Madhya Pradesh government faces in implementing this new scheme. Okay, Apurva, to start with, you know, why are reservations based on place of birth a problem when they go to courts?
Reservations based on place of birth are pretty common in educational institutions. So for admissions, you do have something called the local or domicile quota in every state. So they do prefer candidates in their own. And there is, you know, an argument to be made in favor of that. But reservations based on place of birth are problematic in matters of public employment. And this is because a specific article in the Constitution very categorically says that this is impermissible. So if you look at Article 16, which deals only with equality of opportunity in public employment, there it says in 16 clause 2 that discrimination based on certain grounds is not permissible for public employment. And those grounds include race, caste, sex, place of birth, residence, and even descent. And since the state is supposed to be your model employer, that's why the colloquial understanding is that the government jobs offer you the most benefits. So the state in itself cannot discriminate. And this is expressly said to be unconstitutional in Article 16, Clause 2.
So, you know, you say how this is linked to public jobs, but then you have reservations for other non-caste-based categories, like, say, women or other categories, like maybe even economically backward. How do those kind of fit into that?
When we talk about equality under law, it's not the mathematical sense of equality when it comes to the Constitution. Article 16 that we're talking about, which talks about equality of opportunity in matters of public employment, specifically has a clause which says, despite the mandate that everybody will be treated equally, nothing shall prevent the state from making special provisions for the reservation of backward class of citizens, which in the opinion of the state is not adequately represented in the services under the state. So there is an exception provided in law itself. And from Article 14, the law of equality in the Constitution, all equals will be treated as equals. So it doesn't necessarily mean that everybody will be treated the same.
So that then allows you to make certain specific reservations under groups and say that these groups deserve that reservation and therefore I'm going to give it to them.
Yes. And which groups deserve reservation and how that should work would also follow with the principles in line with the Constitution.
But one can't argue that I am at a sort of disadvantage because I'm from a certain place and therefore I deserve employment.
In certain states, for example, in Karnataka, there is a preference given to people from rural areas. So in state commission services, because it is considered that the rural population is not adequately represented. So their place of birth can be a criteria and that would fall under 16.4. But generally, to use place of birth as a factor and say only people from this region will be given jobs, that would be unconstitutional.
But, you know, you've written about how states like Maharashtra and Uttarakhand have gone with things like, you know, language-based or residency-based reservations. How do those still stay in place? Don't those violate the right to equality?
So language is an interesting factor that plays out here. Many states where there is an official language of business that is specific to only that state, like in Maharashtra or in Tamil Nadu or Karnataka. So these states have language tests. So they say that preliminary knowledge of this language is necessary for you to be a government employee because the state conducts its business in that language. So that becomes a filter, pretty much getting to the same objective, but in a different route. So language is not something that is explicitly prohibited under the Constitution. And obviously, when the files are in, let's say, Marathi, the officer must have a working knowledge of that language. So that becomes appropriate in that case. So in the case of Madhya Pradesh, for example, that cannot be used as a ground. Or even if that is used, like let's say the language in which the state's business is conducted is Hindi, and they say it will be Hindi. Other states where Hindi is the dominant language spoken, they will also be eligible for the same. So states do try and come up with unique, crafty methods to get around this, but it needs to have a specific reason and it has to set out the objective, why it is doing this in order to pass constitutional muster.
Apoorva also pointed out that some states have tried to reserve jobs for state residents in private and government jobs.
Karnataka was mulling a proposal to have preference for Kannadigas in both government and private employment. But in 2017-18, in that year, the Advocate General of the state gave an opinion that this could raise legal questions. He said for private employment, there is no way that the state can ask for a reservation. Also, the states can recommend and sort of issue an advisory that the government would prefer if the private companies hire locals for certain jobs. But there's no way that the government can enforce it. Because practically as well, unlike in government jobs, private jobs do not have an annual hiring mechanism. Also, they don't hire to fill up their vacancies. So it's mostly jobs as required and they would add them as they go along. But for government jobs, the Yediyurappa government just last year issued a notification saying that for class 3 and class 4 jobs in the state, that is blue collar jobs, either be factory workers or similar jobs, better preference would be given to Kannadigas. But the implementation of such laws is still a problem. So how would you determine the status? So that is not looked at as, you can't call that reservation particularly, it's a preference. So it doesn't mean that, let's say, 70% of the jobs have to be given to Kannadigas. It's a preference the government has indicated. But there is still no clarity on how that law will be enforced. In fact, also, the legislation passed by the Andhra Pradesh government state assembly, where they said that 75% of government jobs will be reserved for people from Andhra Pradesh. So that has run into trouble. It's already challenged in the Andhra Pradesh High Court. So we'll have to see how that verdict goes.
Before we get to the next segment, I just wanted your quick attention. One of the big reasons people say that they like this show is because it helps them understand the news better. It provides them with the context they need to see the bigger picture. And there's perhaps no other place that does this better than the Indian Express's Explained section. We on Three Things refer to the section regularly and it helps us make this show. If you're a regular reader of the newspaper, you know how useful the Explained section can be, especially when you're looking for in-depth analysis by the right experts. You can log into indianexpress.com/explained and access their coverage 24/7. Explained by the Indian Express, where news that matters is explained by experts who know the subject. Now, back to the show. After losing Chinese smartphone manufacturer Vivo as its title sponsor, the cash-rich Indian Premier League announced that it had picked a new one, just a month ahead of the scheduled start of the tournament. India's biggest fantasy sports league, Dream 11, is now the title sponsor of the T20 League with a bid of 222 crore rupees after it outbid two online education businesses. Under its deal with the BCCI, Dream 11 is the title sponsor for the IPL for the next 4 months. However, the Indian Express's Shamik Chakrabarty reported that the contract may continue through 2021 and even 2022 if Vivo doesn't return as a title sponsor. But the rise and presence of Dream 11 as a sponsor has been the subject of multiple questions. Mihir Vasavada had reported last year how questions were raised even within the BCCI about bringing in the fantasy sports platform as a sponsor. When I was speaking with Mihir, who also co-hosts the Express Sports podcast, about Dream 11's rise and the questions that it raises. So, Mihir, you know, you reported last year how Dream 11 was already a sponsor of the IPL, right? And what does it mean that they're now a title sponsor?
So, earlier, Dream 11 was one of the sponsors. It had a three-year deal which was worth 120 crore. Now, since they are the title sponsors, they're paying close to 222 crores just for this season. So that's a big difference. And it will be Dream 11 IPL like it was Vivo IPL or Pepsi IPL or DLF IPL before that.
So how much of a loss has this been for the BCCI, or is it sort of a recovery of sorts? How is this being viewed?
It's a glass half full wala situation, I guess. BCCI had a 2,199 crore five-year deal with Vivo, which they signed in 2018. So that amounted to roughly rupees 439.8 crore annually that Vivo paid to BCCI. So Dream 11's contract is worth rupees 222 crore. So BCCI is actually getting 217.8 crores less than they ideally would have.
Okay, now on to Dream 11 itself, right? You've reported in 2019 about how this deal of getting Dream 11 on board itself wasn't a smooth one because there were issues raised. Could you talk about what exactly was the reluctance to bring them on?
So the biggest thing was the legality of it. Since Dream 11 was a relatively new player in this whole market, there were people who are not aware of the way they function, the legality of something like this. So in simple ways, the game is prohibited in 5 states. It had different court verdicts when we go back to 2019, at least it was the case. So it isn't available on Play Store or any equivalent app stores. So these were the issues that were there. And then you also had one IPL franchisee which had raised a red flag. There was another BCCI office bearer who had, when the original sponsorship deal was signed earlier, they had raised red flags. So the main concern was the lack of regulations and the game's legality. Now, when we say game's legality, it basically means that gambling in India is not allowed. It is illegal. Similarly, sports betting is illegal in India. And since there were apprehensions that Dream 11 is treading in that very tiny gray area between sports betting and a legitimate business of fantasy gaming, there were many who were anxious about it.
So, you know, Dream 11 itself argues that it's a game of skill because, you know, like any other fantasy league, you have to choose the players and you win only if those players perform. But, you know, isn't that where the gray area really is, that the performance of the player itself is kind of chance?
That, of course, is one area, and you're using statistics. As a player, the understanding is that professional players would not play this game. But again, it's very difficult to regulate that. That is one of the bigger issues. There are privacy concerns because you have to submit your bank details, your PAN card details. Then you have to make an online transaction before entering a team. So all these issues were obviously there with Dream 11.
And what have courts had to say on platforms like Dream 11? I mean, there are others as well who are in this game. But what are the restrictions they kind of face, and how have they kind of managed to bypass all of that?
So the first, I think, judgment which came in the whole legality of Dream 11 was in 2017, when a Punjab and Haryana High Court ruled in favor of Dream 11. It basically agreed with Dream 11's argument that they are a game of skill. But then you have other courts, which, for example, the Kerala High Court, which in fact ruled, interestingly, that game of skills, which is paid for money, can be considered as gambling. Even the single bench of Gujarat High Court in 2017 said that, again, a game of skill which is played with stakes may be considered as gambling. So these were very different court verdicts which were there. Now, since then, what has happened is the Supreme Court has basically allayed all the concerns, and it has said that it has upheld high court verdicts which have said that this is a game of skill and it is not necessarily gambling. So after that, Dream 11 has gained a bit more legitimacy. But obviously, there are industry experts who continue to raise red flags.
So what are the red flags specifically they're raising? Basically, that it's betting in another form only. Is that the only one, or is there anything else?
That is the main thing. But also, we shouldn't forget that very recently, there was an alleged match-fixing incident in which the BCCI had said that they would be also investigating the role of Dream 11. There hasn't been a lot of update after this, but it was at least in the BCCI Anti-Corruption Unit's report.
So also, you know, say in the English Premier League, you've got multiple betting leagues that are directly sponsoring football clubs, where you've got the symbol of that betting league directly on a player's chest as he plays, right? You could argue that maybe with Dream 11 also, what's wrong with them doing that if they are, so to say, legal in most parts of India? But why do these sort of deals raise questions in England and in, say, the IPL?
So in England, it's more of a moral debate. It's more of an ethical debate. Legally, they're all in the clear because they have very well-defined laws about sports betting and gambling in the UK, as is the case in several other countries. You have sports betting legal in many countries in the world. But when you ask specifically about UK and say, for example, the English Premier League, there has been this debate raging for years whether a sports betting company, a gambling company, should be sponsoring the team or the players just for the ethical reasons. In India, apart from the ethical reasons, which are obviously very serious, there is also the whole legality of it, because sports betting or gambling is not yet legal in our country. However, with Dream 11, the courts have ruled again and again that it is a game of skill, hence it does not amount to betting or gambling. Yet, it remains a very moral/ethical dilemma.
Haven't there been instances, say, in the UK and all of, you know, players being accused of getting their relatives to, say, bet on their team or against their team, and that itself has caused problems in the past?
There have been issues. I can't remember examples top of that, but very recently there was a case of a footballer whose father, I think, bet on
the Daniel Sturridge one, right? Wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah, the Daniel Sturridge one. So, of course, there are cases like that. And when Dream 11 came on as one of the IPL sponsors a couple of years ago, this was a major concern raised by a franchise in their internal memos. But the fact that IPL is vulnerable to a lot of controversies, and also the fact that it is very difficult to monitor a player's individual life or their private life or what their families are doing, it becomes a very interesting situation, because in a Dream 11 app, if you try and play a match over there, you are essentially depending on how a particular player performs. And if he does really well, then you stand to earn anything up to, I mean, a lakh or a crore, depending on what the pot is that day. And similarly, if the player bombs, if he doesn't do that well, then you lose whatever money you have staked. So it depends on a player's performance. And over here, I think we are depending on the whole moral ground of a player that they'll not take part in something like this.
Daniel Sturridge is a footballer who earlier played for Liverpool and has also played for England. When he was at Liverpool, he asked his brother to bet on him being transferred to a Spanish club. For this, he was originally handed a 6-week ban that was later amended to 4 months.
And not even just the player, right? Like in Sturridge's case, if you have his uncle or someone betting or, you know, with some internal knowledge, doesn't that becomes another sort of gray area where we are not quite clear what to do, right?
Exactly, that's true. And one of the many interesting scenarios that we find ourselves in is, of course, this is an area of concern. But then again, you have players who are brand ambassadors of this app, of this game. So you have MS Dhoni, who is the face of Dream 11. And then on the other hand, you have Saurav Ganguly, who kind of promotes another rival fantasy game. Virat Kohli has his own little thing there going on. So there are Indian players, Indian sports administrators who are the face of multiple fantasy gaming platforms.
You know, like even Magnus Carlsen has his own football fantasy league, right? And everyone watches it to see what changes he's made. And you have these whole debates about his team and things like that. Do you think we'll ever reach that kind of scenario with Dream 11 and all, where say a Dhoni can say, look, this is my team? Or because of the cash element, he can never really do that?
Because of the cash element, of course, I don't know the legality of it. It's a very interesting question, actually. I don't know how that would stand legally.
So does this mean now, I mean, as you said, Saurav Ganguly, Mahindra Singh Dhoni, Rohit Sharma, Virat Kohli, there's so many cricketers who are involved in this league or multiple leagues. Does this mean we're just going to be seeing a sort of boom period for this sort of industry for the next few years now?
I think so, especially with Dream 11 now bagging the IPL rights. I guess Dream 11 would get bigger for sure, because they will then hold multiple rights with regards to the player rights, their image rights and everything. I think all that would be woven into contract if Dream 11's deal is a long-term one. So Dream 11 certainly would benefit a lot from this. And there are close to 70, 80 other players who are in the fantasy gaming market. And it's such a huge thing now. I mean, if we go beyond the whole cricket bit, so for example, Dream 11 itself, it goes into fantasy gaming in sports like football and hockey and basketball. It's a wide range of sports that these apps now cover, these games now cover. And then you also have stuff like Rummy or something like that. So it goes beyond your conventional sports as well. It is set to boom. And I think in that sense, Dream 11 getting IPL sponsorship would be a big multiplier for these platforms.
Over 2 months after actor Sushant Singh Rajput's death in his Mumbai home, the Supreme Court asked the Central Bureau of Investigation, or CBI, to investigate his death. The order came after the Bihar government sought a CBI probe into the case filed by the actor's father against actor Riya Chakrabarty and her family members for allegedly abetting Sushant's suicide. The Supreme Court directed the Mumbai police, which was conducting an inquiry into the actor's death, to hand over all the evidence it had collected so far to the CBI. Sushant's death on the 14th of June had become the subject of a turf war between the Bihar and Mumbai police. The probe by the Mumbai police had already seen several Hindi film personalities being questioned. The Enforcement Directorate also began probing allegations by Sushant's father that Chakrabarty and her family members siphoned about 15 crore rupees from Sushant's bank accounts. However, as the Indian Express reported earlier, the agency has so far found nothing against Chakrabarty. Many welcomed the Supreme Court's verdict on social media, including Hindi film actors and Sushant's fans. However, the Supreme Court verdict was a reason for cheer in Bihar, with all the major political parties taking credit for taking up the matter and the case being transferred to the CBI. You were listening to The Three Things by The Indian Express. Today's show was written and produced by me, Arun George, and as always, was edited and mixed by our producer, Joshua Thomas. Before we go, here's another reminder to check out Indian Express's Explained page. You can log on to indianexpress.com/explained and find in-depth analysis by the right experts. It has everything you need to know to understand the news better and see the bigger picture. If you like the show, then do subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts. You can also recommend the show to someone you think will like it. Share it with a friend or someone in your family. It's the best way for people to get to know about us. You can also tweet us at Express Audio and write to us at podcast@indianexpress.com.